Thank you very much for the introduction. It is my great pleasure to be present at this conference and give talk here. And it's always very, very nice to meet and see all my friends and colleagues from Kyiv. And today I have opted to talk about Boolean inverse semigroup. So let me first introduce the topic. So and start from recalling the classical stone duality. So Boolean algebra is a relatively complemented distributive lattice, which has bottom element, but not necessarily top element. In the literature, such Boolean algebras are often called generalized Boolean algebras. Well, and one can wonder what is the structure of Boolean algebras. And finite Boolean algebras are precisely power sets of finite sets. It's easy to see. And but it's difficult to observe that it's not true that each Boolean algebra is isomorphic to some power set. And the easiest way to make sure it's not so is to consider the following example. Consider set of natural numbers and the set of its finite subsets. It's not yet a Boolean algebra, but if we add cofinite subsets, that is sets which have finite complements, we get a Boolean algebra of finite and cofinite subsets of natural numbers. Yes, this is countable Boolean algebra, but it's easy to see that any infinite power set is of cardinality at least continuum, because power set of natural numbers has cardinality continuum. So we have kind of too many subsets, and how to get rid of some subsets, topologize. So we throw away some subsets and we define the structure of topological space. So duals of Boolean algebras will not be just power sets, but sets of some selected sets of some topological spaces. And we arrive to the definition of stone space. It's Hausdorff space with basis of compact open sets. And stone duality due to Marshall stone is that categories of Boolean algebras and stone spaces are dually equivalent. Initially, it was formulated just at the level of objects, but in a less well-known paper by Doctor, strict categorical equivalence is established. And for Boolean algebras which don't have top element, morphisms are so-called proper morphisms, both on topological and on algebraic side. So, now I go on to non-commutative stone dualities. So we want to generalize this to non-commutative structures such as inverse semigroups whose idempotents form Boolean algebra. Okay, so I'm sorry. So Boolean inverse semigroup are the object of this talk. But I want to remark that results and ideas in this talk admit extensions to distributive inverse semigroups, to pseudogroups, to complete restriction semigroups, etc. And another remark I'd like to make is that another non-commutative direction to generalize Boolean algebras are skew Boolean algebras. And this is done in works by Jonathan Leach and other contributors. And also I have made a couple of contributions to this field. So what is a Boolean inverse semigroup? It's an inverse semigroup. I suppose that people here know what an inverse semigroup is, so I don't recall the definition now, such that idempotents of S admit the structure of Boolean algebra. Okay, and another quite technical condition that compatible pairs of elements have join. Two elements are compatible. If we think of elements as of partial bijections, then two partial bijections are compatible when they agree restricted to intersection of domains and to intersection of ranges. Okay, so examples. Any Boolean algebra is example of Boolean inverse semigroup consisting of idempotents only. And second example is symmetric inverse semigroup on a set X. It's an important form Boolean algebra, just power set of X. And abstract Boolean inverse semigroups could be thought about as generalization of symmetric inverse semigroup. Now what are duals of Boolean inverse semigroups? For Boolean algebras, these were stone spaces. Here we have stone groupoids. And I'm sorry, I should go back, I think. Let me first introduce the notion of et al. Groupoid. Let us recall that the groupoid is a small category where every arrow is invertible. And we define a unit set, we define domain and source maps, and there is also a range map, a set of composable arrows. So two arrows are composable if end of first arrow coincides with beginning of second arrow. Now, local bisection in a groupoid, I will now explain a little bit later in an example why should we consider bisections, is a subset of groupoids such that restrictions of domain and range maps to it are injective. And topological groupoid is groupoid which has structure of topological space and structure maps are continuous, but domain and range maps are local homeomorphisms. In this case, we call groupoid et al. Groupoid. So topological groupoid is et al. If domain and then also range maps are all local homeomorphisms. And now we are almost ready to formulate the non-commutative stone duality. So stone groupoid is et al. Groupoid whose space of identities is stone space. And now a series of papers by Mark Lawson initiated this direction, but also I want to mention paper by Pedro Rezende, my joint work with Mark Lawson and work by Mark Lawson and Daniel Lenz. And so result which I want to mention here is that categories of Boolean inverse semigroups and stone groupoids are dually equivalent. And now how this equivalence is established, just a brief idea of the proof. So if we have stone groupoid, we consider its local bisections. So more precisely, local bisections which are compact open and they form a Boolean inverse semigroup. The other way around, if we are given a Boolean inverse semigroup, then germs of elements over points of the space of ultra characters give rise to a stone groupoid. Okay, so in order that this doesn't sound very difficult, let me illustrate this duality on a simple example of symmetric inverse semigroup. So let me go to my board. So now you see on screen my board, and so let's do symmetric inverse, consider symmetric inverse semigroup I5, so on five elements, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So what is its attached stone groupoid? These are just all rank one elements. So we just draw like 1, 2, 3 is example of rank one element and the arrow of this groupoid. Objects are just 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So identities are these loops. And I won't draw all arrows, but we need to draw all possible arrows because these are all possible rank one elements. So it's dual stone groupoid. And now how to collect I5 back from its dual stone groupoid, we need to consider a local bisection. So let's try to do this. So for example, if I take, 1, 3 and join to it, 2, 4 and join to it 5, 2, 5, this gives rise to the element of symmetric inverse semigroup 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And here you have 3, 4, 5 and these don't have image, okay? But here we should be careful. So why it's important to have bisections? Because if, for example, I draw here arrow like 2 to 4 and I try to join 1, 3, I'm sorry, 2 to 4 is already occupied. So let me do some other arrow like 2 to 5, say. So if I do 1, 3, 2, 4 and 2, 5. It's not good. Okay, put cross here. It's not good. It doesn't give rise to element of symmetric inverse semigroup because 2 is used 2 times here, and this doesn't give rise to partial bijection. But this says that what we have done now is not a local bisection because 2 elements have the same domain, 2. And for local bisection, domain map restricted to it must be injective. So let me return to my slides of my talk. Yes. So Now the next thing I'd like to discuss is Booleanization of any inverse semigroup. So now we start from an arbitrary inverse semigroup, and we wonder, is there a universal Boolean inverse semigroup such that any morphism from given inverse semigroup to any Boolean inverse semigroup factors through this universal Boolean inverse semigroup, as is depicted on the diagram? And this Boolean inverse semigroup B of S is called Booleanization of S. Okay, and representation of S, I didn't mention this, is just a morphism of semigroup which preserves the bottom element. So for any morphism, for any representation of S in Boolean inverse semigroup B, it can be factored through B of S, okay? And then B of S is called Booleanization. And we have questions, does Booleanization exist? And if it does exist, how to construct it? So let us consider these questions, sorry. First of all, I'd like to consider the case of a semilattice. Here the answer is very simple. We consider set of characters where character is a non-zero representation in two-element Boolean algebra 0,1. Topology on character set is inherited from a product topology 0,1 to power e. And this topology is called patch topology. And we have the following fact, that if we consider this space with this topology, then it's a stone space. So by classical stone duality, it has a dual Boolean algebra of compact opens. And this is precisely Booleanization of given semilattice. And now having said this, we go to Booleanization of arbitrary inverse semigroups. So if we have an arbitrary inverse semigroup, we can consider character space of its idempotent semilattice. And now we consider the following action of S on character space of its idempotent semilattice. So if you have S of S and phi of a character, then S dot phi is defined as follows. So it's defined if and only if phi of S minus one to S equals to one. Okay, this must hold. In which case, S phi is a new character whose value on E is value of phi on S to minus one ES. Okay. And now suppose that we have two elements of S and we have characters such that S phi and P phi are both defined. And we now say that they define the same germ over phi if there is an idempotent E such that phi of E is one and SE equals to TE, kind of that S and T have restriction, okay? Have common element which is below both of them such that phi of the domain of its element is still one, okay? Then we cannot distinguish between these elements, kind of, they define the same germ over phi. And we can visualize this as follows. We look at the germ S phi as an arrow from phi to S phi, and this gives rise to a groupoid. This groupoid is called groupoid of germs. And actually it's well-known groupoid, it's Patterson's universal groupoid of inverse semigroup S. It is a stone groupoid with patch topology, which I don't define here. And because it's stone groupoid, it has by non-commutative stone duality, it has a dual Boolean inverse semigroup G of S. And this turns out to be the Booleanization of S. Okay, so it's the universal Boolean inverse semigroup for S. And so it exists, S embeds into it, and I have presented the construction of the Booleanization. So now, actually, another thing which I didn't yet mention, why are we interested to consider Booleanizations of arbitrary inverse semigroups? It's motivated by developments in series of combinatorial sister algebras and of Steinberg algebras, which are purely algebraic analogs of sister algebras, of combinatorial and groupoid sister algebras. So actually, the general scheme is as follows. Starting from some combinatorial object, one constructs an inverse semigroup. From this inverse semigroup, one constructs an et al. Groupoid, and by non-commutative stone duality, we know that it's the same as to construct Booleanization of this inverse semigroup. And then from this et al. Groupoid, one constructs a sister algebra or Steinberg algebra. And very often, these objects have rich structure and very nice and often extreme properties. So let me consider the following example. So I consider semigroup, which consists of 1, 0, and all words in letters P1, P2, Q1, Q2, subject to the relation Qi, Pj equals delta ij, where delta ij, delta is Kronecker delta. And this is an inverse semigroup where Pi to minus 1 equals to Qi, and it's called polycyclic inverse monoid on two generators. Here we only attached 0, so it's P2 with 0 attached. So now we can consider the following representation of this semigroup on Hilbert space H. So let S1 and S2 be two isometries with orthogonal ranges on H. So we can define sigma of Pi equals to Si. And actually it's the definition implies that if we put sigma of Qi equals to Si star, then very similar equality holds for the images. So S I to Sj star equals to delta ij, just because S and 2 are isometries with orthogonal ranges. And that's why this assignment leads to representation of S on H. So actually, starting from S, we can construct its Booleanization, and we can construct its dual et al. Groupoid. The sister algebra assigned to this groupoid is well known, and it's isomorphic to Kunz-Toeplitz algebra KO2. But the most well known algebra is Kunz algebra, which satisfies additional requirement S1 S star plus S2 S2 star equals to 1. And so Booleanization is not the right object to obtain Kunz algebra. We need something different. And actually, here one has a problem. So how to capture this condition, this plus condition by the representation sigma? Well, so what is the aim? From inverse semigroup S, we aim to get new Boolean inverse semigroup, not Booleanization, but something else, and then get dual et al. Groupoid so that O2 is the attached sister algebra. And the answer is already suggested here. It's written B type of S, so it's tight Booleanization of S or respectively tight groupoid of S. So what is this? Actually, one needs notion of cover to join representation. So let's start from cover to join representations of semilattices. So if you have a semilattice E, then a subset is called cover of E. If for each element below E, there is element Z of this cover, which has non-zero intersection with F. So if you try to visualize it, it's something which replaces joins for our simulators, because simulators is not equipped with join operation. Yes, and cover is kind of something which can be thought about at some approximation of the notion of join. So it's kind of on the level of intuition. So representation of simulators E in Boolean algebra B is called cover to join. If for each E, for each idempotent E and any finite cover Z of E, we have that phi of E is join over E over Z. So on the right hand side, you have join because we are in Boolean algebra. And on the left hand side, E is of similarity. So we map element E to Boolean algebra and of Z. Outer join representations are closely related to tight representations, and actually, in many important cases, they're actually the same. And there is a paper by Ruhr Axel with discussion of the relationship between these notions. So, by E hat tight, we denote the tight spectrum of E, so it's the space of all tight characters of E. And it turns out that. We can define, okay, we consider its dual Boolean inverse semigroup, which is called tight Booleanization of S. And it turns out that sister algebra constructed from tight groupoid is a sister algebra which is isomorphic to the Kunz algebra O2. And of course, because to construct B tight S, we add additional restrictions, okay, then it's quotient of universal Booleanization. And very many examples described in the literature, sister algebras can be constructed from Booleanization of inverse semigroup or from tight Booleanization of inverse semigroups. However, recent examples considered, which have appeared in the literature, demonstrate that some sister algebras which arise in a natural way do not arise neither from Booleanization nor from tight Booleanization of inverse semigroup. So this general scheme doesn't work. So combinatorial object, then inverse semigroup, then a tau groupoid, and then sister algebra. So we have two choices for a tau groupoid: dual groupoid of Booleanization or tight groupoid. And if both of these options fail, we need new technique how to assign groupoid to this inverse semigroup to obtain the right sister algebra. And I mentioned some examples which have occurred in the literature. So Matsumoto sister algebra and Carlson Matsumoto sister algebra. These examples are considered in paper by Excel and Steinberg, and they provided the groupoid models. And in my work, I consider intermediate boundary quotients of the sister algebra of Zapasa product of right LCM semigroup. And also intermediate quotients of sister algebras of right LCM semigroups. And I will mention it to the end of my talk. So now the technique which I'd like to introduce. So instead of curvature join representations, I consider arbitrary X to join representations. So what do I require? S X is a set consisting of pairs. First component is idempotent. Second component is finite set of idempotents. And I require that phi of E equals to join I equals 1 to N phi of EE. So you see it's the same requirement as for curvature join representation, but now I don't consider covers. I consider any set X. X can be whatever, okay? And similarly, as for tight representations, we have space of X to join characters, it's stone space, and we can consider X to join Booleanization of simulated E. So what about inverse semigroups? We can play similar game as before. We should be a little bit careful because it may happen that the set X is not invariant under the action of X, of S. If it's not invariant, then we consider it's the smallest S invariant subset that contains S. So this can be corrected. So groupoid of germs of this restriction action is denoted by GXS. Okay, like G of S or G tight S, but this is GXS. And from this groupoid, one can construct groupoid sister algebras. Actually, what is interesting about this Boolean inverse semigroup, which is dual to this groupoid, I call it X to join Booleanization of S. And as expected, it has universal property with respect to all X to join representations of S. But it turns out that every weakly mid-preserving quotient of Booleanization arises as such a Booleanization for suitable set X. Okay. So now, do I have time? Actually, I wanted to present a presentation of Boolean inverse semigroups in terms of as algebras. For this, we need difference operation and skew join operation, and Boolean inverse semigroups form a variety of algebras. It was proved by Vichrun in 2017. And actually, then I have found presentation of BXS in terms of generators and relations in my recent paper. Well, perhaps I skip this slide. It's technical, so it's definition of X to join the presentation of inverse semigroup in sister algebras. Well, it goes just similarly to X to join representation in Boolean inverse semigroups using the correspondence between Boolean rings and Boolean algebras. Okay, so one has at hand definition of representation of inverse semigroup, X to join representation of inverse semigroup in a sister algebra. And now to introduce my results, which I mentioned about intermediate boundary quotients, just a couple of definitions. So right LCM semigroup, it's left conservative semigroup as such that intersection of any two principal right ideals is either empty or is a principal right ideal. And actually, what I want to consider, semigroups which arise as Zappa-Zapp product of two semigroups U and A, which satisfy a series of additional requirements. So what is a supercept product? It's generalization of semi-direct product. So you have semi-group, you have two semi-groups whose intersection is E, a unit element, and each element can be written uniquely as U times A. So if you have A times U, it can be switched to U prime times A prime, okay? And sister algebras of these semigroups have been considered in the literature, actually, by Brown, Love, Ramach, Robertson, and Whittaker. And actually, they consider also boundary quotient of this semigroup, and they found its relations defining it. And actually, it follows from result of Starling that this is groupoid sister algebra. But now I want to mention two intermediate boundary quotients. So one of them, so please look at this diagram, is so-called additive, and second one is multiplicative boundary quotients, so QA and QU. This goes from prototypical example of this construction, so semigroup of natural number by multiplication, semi-direct product of semigroup of natural numbers. And so these quotients arise naturally. And question was if these quotients admit groupoid models, and from my technique of extra joint representations, it follows this, they do admit groupoid models. And this also answers question of Nikolai Stemmeyer, who considered the sister algebras of more general right LCM semigroups, this intermediate quotient, and he wondered if they admit groupoid models, and I have answered this question in the affirmative. Thank you very much for your attention.